So let's talk about some of the things that people can do. And I've kind of batched these into categories rather than just diving right into actionable protocols. So the first one relates to food, blood sugar, insulin. This is something I hear a lot about, that fasting is good for us, but rarely do I hear why it's good for us. And one of the reasons I'm excited to talk to you today is because I want to drill into the details of this, because I think understanding the mechanism will allow people to make better choices and not simply to just decide whether or not they're going to fast or not fast or how long they're going to fast. I think should be dictated by some understanding of the mechanism. So why is it that having elevated blood sugar, glucose, and insulin ages us more quickly? And or why is it that having periods of time each day or perhaps longer can extend our lifespan?
Well, let's start with what I think was a big mistake, was the idea that people should never be hungry. We live in a world now where there's at least three meals a day, and then we've got companies selling bars and snacks in between. So the feeling of hunger, some people never experience hunger in their whole lives. It's really, really bad for them. It was based, I believe, on the 20th century view that you don't want to stress out the pancreas, and you try to keep insulin levels pretty steady and not have this fluctuation. What we actually found, my colleagues and I, across this field of longevity, is that when you look at, first of all, animals, whether it's a dog or a mouse or a monkey, the ones that live the longest, by far, 30% longer and stay healthy, are the ones that don't eat all the time. Actually, it was first discovered back in the early 20th century, but people ignored it. And then it was rediscovered in the 1930s. Clive McKay did caloric restriction. He put cellulose in the food of rats so they couldn't get as many calories even though they ate. And those rats lived 30% longer. But then it went away. And then it came back in the 2000s in a big way when a couple of things happened. One is that my lab and others showed that there are longevity genes in the body that come on and protect us from aging and disease. The group of genes that I work on are called sirtuins, there's seven of them. And we showed in 2005 in a science paper that if you have low levels of insulin and another molecule called insulin-like growth factor, those low levels turn on the longevity genes. One of them that's really important is called SIRT1. But by having high levels of insulin all day, being fed, means your longevity genes are not switched on. So you're falling apart, your epigenome, your information that keeps your cells functioning over time just degrades quicker. Your clock is ticking faster by always being fed, okay? The other thing that I think might be happening by always having food around is that it's not allowing the cell to have periods of rest and reestablish the epigenome. And so it also is accelerating in that direction. There's plenty of other reasons as well that are not as profound, such as having low levels of glucose in your body will trigger your major muscles and your brain to become more sensitive to insulin and suck the glucose out of your bloodstream, which is very good. You don't want to have glucose flowing around too much. And that will ward off type 2 diabetes.
So hunger, of course, is associated with low blood glucose and low insulin. Do you think there's anything about the subjective experience of hunger itself that could be beneficial for longevity?
Yeah, I do. Though you get used to the feeling of not eating, so I'm kind of screwed that way.
It's like cold water. You eventually adapt.
You get used to it, unfortunately. But there are some studies that are being done at the National Institutes of Health that are able to simulate the effect of hunger but still provide the calories. And it's looking like there's a small component that's due to hunger. But most of it actually is because you've got these periods of not being fed, and then the body turns on these defensive genes. There's a really interesting experiment that was published maybe a couple of years ago by Rafael DiCarbo down at the NIH. What he did was he took over 10,000 mice and gave them different combinations of fat, carbohydrate, protein, and he was trying to figure out what was the best combination. And then he also cleverly had a group, well, two groups, one that was fed all the time or ate as much as they wanted, and the other group was only given food for an hour a day. And it turns out they ate roughly the same amount of calories, because of course in an hour, they're stuffing their faces. It turns out it didn't matter what diet he gave them. It was only the group that ate within that window that lived longer and dramatically longer. So my conclusion is, and mice are very similar to us metabolically, I think that tells us that it's not as important what you eat, it's when you eat during the day.
What is the protocol that people can extrapolate from that? Or maybe I should just ask you, what is your protocol for when to eat and when to avoid food? Do you fast? Do you ever fast longer than 24 hours? What do you do? And what do you think is a good jumping off place if people want to explore this as a protocol?
Well, if there's one thing I could say, I would say definitely try to skip a meal a day. That's the best thing.
Does it matter which meal, or are they essentially equivalent?
Well, as long as it's at the end or the beginning of the day, because then you add that to the sleep period where you're hopefully not eating.
I think that's an excellent point. I realize it's a simple one, but I think it's an excellent one because I think one of the things that people struggle with the most is knowing when and how to initiate this so-called intermittent fasting. And the middle of the day obviously is not tacked to the sleep cycle in the same way. So it's much harder as well for many people.
Yeah. Well, I'll tell you what I do. I skip breakfast. I have a tiny bit of yogurt or olive oil because the supplements I have need to be dissolved in it. And then I go throughout the whole day as I'm doing right now here with this this glass of water here. I'm just keeping myself filled with liquids and so I don't feel hungry. Beware that the first 2 to 3 weeks when you try that, you will feel hungry. And you also have a habit of wanting to chew on something. There's a lot of physical parts to it. But try to make it through the first 3 weeks and do without breakfast or do without dinner. You'll get through it. And I did that for most of my life, actually. Mainly because I wasn't hungry in the morning. Some people are very hungry in the morning and they may want to consider skipping dinner instead. But I will go throughout the whole day. I don't get the crashes of the high glucose and the low glucose. Anyone who goes, oh man, it's 3 o'clock, I'm gonna need a sleep. If you do what I do, you will not experience that anymore. Because what my body does is it regulates blood sugar levels naturally. My liver is putting out glucose when it needs to and it's very steady and gives me pure focus throughout the day. And I don't even have to think about lunch, I'm just powering through. At dinner, I love food as much as anybody. So I will eat a regular, pretty healthy meal. I'll try to eat mostly vegetables. I can eat some fish, some shrimp. I rarely will eat a steak. In fact, my microbiome is so adapted to my diet. Now, if I eat a steak, it will not get digested very well. I'll feel terrible.
If I don't eat a steak, I feel terrible.
Well,
Argentine lineage, but we can talk about that some other time.
Well, everybody's different. I mean, that's the other thing. What works for me may not be perfect for you, and we do have to measure things to know what's working. I rarely eat dessert. I gave up dessert and sugar when I turned 40. And occasionally I'll steal a bit of dessert because it doesn't hurt if you steal it, right? But other than that, I avoid sugar, which includes simple carbohydrates. Bread, I try to avoid. I've actually noticed, this is just a side note, I used to get buildup of plaque pretty easily. And every time I went to the dentist, they'd have to scrape it off. And I even bought tools to scrape it off because it was driving me nuts. I don't get plaque anymore. And I think it's because of my diet. I don't have those sugars in my mouth that the bacteria feed on and then form the biofilm on the teeth. Much better breath, by the way.